There's a lot of great things happening at Tennessee Athletics.
I believe this city is going to be upside down tonight.
Season-long party continues at Rocky Top.
Welcome back, y'all, to another episode of the Everything Orange podcast. For today's episode, we're kind of switching things up, trying something a little new, but I promise you guys are really going to like this one. Today's guests, plural, are both upcoming juniors on the football team who are a big part of Tennessee's culture and growth over the past two seasons. A wide receiver and a running back, an Alabama native and a Baton Rouge kid, two program standouts who just so happen to be besties off the field. So please welcome to the Everything Orange podcast, Squirrel White and Dylan Sampson. Squirrel White, Dylan Sampson, thank you so much for joining me on the podcast today.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
So I want to do some fun, most likely two questions to kind of break the ice between you guys. So I'm going to start off with this. Okay. Most likely to get yelled at the most by their position coach.
Okay. Yeah. Probably not you, because I ain't going to lie. Like,
I don't know. I'll probably say probably me, just because, like,
Cause Pope,
like, he
just love the game, you know what I'm saying?
Forget someone's birthday, whether it be like a parent.
Me.
Okay.
It's me, I'm not gonna lie. Like, I know my parents' birthdays and everything, mm-hmm. but like, when it comes to other stuff, like, it just be down the back, like the back of my brain.
Like, when my birthday?
Cinco de Mayo.
Okay, when's Dylan's?
Come on. It's him.
Yeah, it's him.
Do you know the month?
You know the month.
I know it. Freak.
It's during football season. During football season.
It's September.
Okay.
September what?
September 15th. It's like.
You glow.
It's single digits.
No, you close. You really close, actually.
September 12th.
No.
13th.
Nope.
17th.
Nope. You actually skipped it. 16. No.
14th.
Yeah.
Okay.
So is him,
okay,
actually.
Okay.
Yeah,
so
but mine is like easy to like remember, like Cinco de Mayo, like Mayfield, like that's easy.
I made it known.
Okay, start cramping during their touchdown celebration.
It's most definitely him. Most definitely him.
Has it happened before?
I do be having long
touchdown runs.
Yeah. Okay, but hold on. You don't remember in Virginia when you was laid out?
Oh,
well,
yeah.
I thought you died.
Man. Bro, when you have like a cramp, like you just gotta stay there, like just sit there, like.
Mm-hmm. Yo, head did not move.
Hey, what move?
Sleep through their alarm.
Most definitely.
Yeah. Do you snooze it a lot in the morning?
I don't snooze it. I always press the button. So I had like 15 alarms. Like,
okay. Cause
like,
you stop it, but then there's another one going off in a couple minutes.
Yeah.
His alarms got songs.
Yeah, I got different songs for my alarm.
Okay.
Just so I never get tired of one sound.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
I have the same beeping one.
That everybody has?
Yeah.
Yeah, I had to get rid of that one.
Yeah.
Because that still gives me PTSD to this day.
Honestly.
I'll be waking up before my alarms, actually.
Okay. That's so great.
Lucky
yeah.
you.
Yeah, must be nice being a morning person. Couldn't be me. Has the most unread text messages?
Oh, no.
Where are you at? Are you in the hundreds?
He don't be looking at his text. He don't be looking at his text.
What's that?
How do you know?
Yeah, how do you?
Look at the little red bubble, mm-mm. right? Do you not have your notifications on for your text messages?
Ooh, 942.
How much I got? 44.
44.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, 942.
You probably got something from 2016.
Yeah.
Spontaneously come home with a puppy from the animal shelter.
Him.
I do, because I actually got a puppy.
He did that one day.
No
like,
way.
Like, yeah, this dude, yeah. He FaceTimed me. I'm like, I got a dog. A dog.
I had to get a dog.
Okay, know? What was it?
It's a husky.
Oh my god! Oh my gosh!
Pretty
was it
dog.
From the animal shelter, or did you go to a breeder?
I went to a breeder.
Okay. Oh my gosh!
But
how
like,
old?
He'll do
she's
that.
What? 6 months now.
Is she well behaved?
She a little bad. Like when she see new people, she get too excited. She like every time she see like new people, she jump around and like next thing you know, she just start peeing. So,
like, she wasn't bad at Bama though.
Nah, yeah, she won. She was.
You take her on the road with you?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, she was chilling. Yeah, she was cool.
Okay, a little bit about your hometowns. Squirrel, I'll start with you. Birmingham, Alabama,
mm-hmm.
hometown. Talk to me about what life was like for you growing up there, and what you remember about
the area and what you would do like during your free time when you weren't playing football.
Okay, so yeah, growing up in Birmingham, Alabama, I'm a city boy, something like that. Stay with my mom, two brothers, and one sister. The only thing I can like really remember like growing up there was like just me playing like backyard football with my brothers, playing football in the house, you know, and yeah. But Birmingham itself is it's pretty cool. It's chill there. If you do want to go, I recommend like you go like to Hoover, Alabama. That's nice spots down there.
Okay. So, yeah, I drove through Birmingham and it was a lot more city than I thought. I don't know what I was expecting, but I was like, oh, it's kind of like a Knoxville almost.
Yeah,
like it's
that's
pretty comparable.
That's one of the reasons why like I really wanted to come here, just because like it reminded me back at home.
Mm-hmm. Where are you in the pecking order with your siblings?
I'm the knee baby.
Okay. When you were playing football and stuff in the backyard, were they always beating up on you? Were you beating up on them?
It was hand in hand. Yeah. I used to like think that I was Cam Newton. Like I used to like try to jump over like my brothers and stuff, like to get to the end zone. Yeah. So yeah, that was pretty fun.
Okay, nice. All right, Dylan, Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Talk to me about what it was like growing up there.
Boo.
Yeah. Yeah. Obviously, great food and culture is, you know, very different from a lot of places, a lot of cities in the United States, Louisiana in general. You go down there, like the people you meet, the energy they have, that's what make it, like makes it, you know, kind of fun in a sense. Generally, like it's nothing there. Like Baton Rouge is maybe the capital city, but it don't even look like a city for real. Like
okay.
They got the downtown part and that's like it. Like I remember when we flew in to Baton Rouge for LSU, people was asking me like, what is this? I'm like, look, bro, I told you, it's country, mm-hmm. like for mm-hmm. real. Yeah. But I just growing up, I mean, similar to him, I grew up with two brothers and a younger sister.
Okay.
But, you know, I just remember always being outside, you know, playing in the street. I used to, like me and my friends, they used to have this, was a little path, a little trail we used to go between this grass to get to this this basketball court that used to be off the road, about a 10 minute. I'd be like, mama, I'm finna go outside. All right. So I go, but I spent a lot of my time also, my parents are from around Central Louisiana, a place called Marksville,
okay.
Evolves Parish. We have parishes, not counties, just so everybody that doesn't know that.
Okay.
Grew up there a lot. And you talk about real country. I'm talking about riding horses, always in the field. Like, I have so many cousins. On my mom's side of the family, she's the youngest of 15, so youngest 14.
Wow.
So I just grew around a lot of family, a lot of older family too. But, you know, just always outside, eating good food, mm-hmm. you know, so that was kind of like my childhood.
Yeah, I was going to ask, like Southern Alabama cooking, Louisiana style, Cajun food, what do you miss the most about the home cooking from where
you're from? Man, I miss that fried chicken. Fried chicken is like my number one like favorite thing to eat. Like, it's just good. You put that hot sauce and the ketchup on the fried chicken, it's good, I'm telling you.
Fried chicken, yeah. It's all that, you know what I'm saying? It just seemed like everything that my people cooked was just, you know what I'm saying, good. You know, like I wouldn't ask no questions. They'd just put the food in front of me and I eat, you know, like
yeah.
I grew up eating rice and like gravy chicken and everything. So like real deal. Like, so if I don't have a meal without rice, I don't feel complete, you know, but that Louisiana food is also something you really can't get
anywhere
like
else.
Nowhere else. Like, yeah. Every now and then, I'll try to experiment down here, and it just disappoints.
No.
So I'll just cook instead.
Disappoints?
Huh?
Oh, no, not yet.
Yeah, like the other day, like I walked, and a sign said red beans and rice. So I'm like, I'll give it a shot. And I walked in, but I asked the owner, I'm like, where's the owner from? They said Georgia. I was with another one of my team. We looked at it, another one of my teammates. We looked at each other. We said, Yeah, but nah, that I definitely miss the food.
Mm-hmm. Talk to you about a little bit of the role models that you guys were watching when you were younger, maybe in the NFL or even at the high school level that you were aspiring to want to be.
I'll say for me, Odell Beckham Jr. played a part of me, like playing football. I'm pretty sure like everybody, like he's known for his one hand catch, his hair and stuff. Just him just being who he is and stuff like that. I try to take my game after him. And then actually, I looked up to one of my guys. He was older than me in high school football. His name was Jamichael Thompson. I always wanted to be like him, like how he ran his routes. He like put his head down and like just showed that like he was digging out. And then like at the last minute, he'll like stop. And like, I really liked that. The coach said something about that. And like, I just wanted to apply that to my game. So yeah, him for sure.
I'll start with one of the people that I think helped develop me into the person I am today. His name was Lance Williams. He's on my summer track team. So I started running summer track when I was in like sixth grade, and I wasn't even playing football at the time. Like, I didn't start playing football again until I was in like seventh grade. But yeah, Lance Williams, he's from New Orleans. I'm talking about like role model. Like, everything he did was like, you go to the track meets, he was winning races, like competing against the best, Junior Olympics. He did 100, 200 long jump, so I did 100, 200 long jump. You know, like, that was like the first big brother outside of my big brothers that I can remember. And he had the perfect balance of like knowing how to have fun and play and joke, but he knew when it was time to work, it was time to work. So I really grew once I started realizing like, man, I gotta be like better than him, you know? So I would just go off with him, with Lance, and work with Lance, like at practice. Let everybody else do. My dad was like, let all them, we not driving, cause we had to drive to this place called like St. James, drive out like 40, 45 minutes right after my dad got off of work. And he'd be like, look, I'm not going out there for you to be playing around and this and that. So like, man, Lance took me under his wing. Just showed me the ropes of the game, and I saw how successful he was. And he, like I said before, he was just like a big brother to me outside of my big brothers. And obviously, I talk about it all the time. Alvin Kamara, when I first learned about him, I knew about him when he was here, but then he got drafted to the Saints. So I was like, man, it just must be meant to be for me to, you know what I'm saying, find out a little bit more about this person. So I just got invested with the way he played the game, you know, not being a big running back. I saw parts of his game that I could take in mind. So I started getting invested with his story too. So I just looked how he got to the places he got to, how he ended up where he was, you know, his mindset. So those are two big key factors, I think, okay, in my development.
You talked about track, and you guys both have a background in track when you guys were in high school. Can you talk to me about your thoughts on dual sport athletes in high school? Because I know that's like a hot topic with people being like, you should either be one track when you hit high school and like that's end game for you to get to college, or people are like, be well-rounded, have different sports in your back pockets because you learn different skills through each one. So what are your thoughts on it, and how did track influence you and your athletic ability?
I feel like, yeah, you should be a dual threat. Like, run track, you can play basketball, like, you can do it all in high school. But I'd say, like, once you get to college, like really just focus on that one sport that you really want, that, like, when you got here. So, but I did run track in high school. I should have ran all my high school years, but I only ran, like, 1 year. Okay. It was my junior year. It really, like, it helped me a lot, though. I feel like I had got faster and stuff like that.
Like you said before, I think it's important to just do multiple sports, you know what I'm saying? Open up many opportunities, because being one track like minded in high school, you know what I'm saying? Just because you don't really know where you'll end up. So you might as well just put yourself in every, you know, if you have those skill sets and you know, you love what you do, like, you're only high school once, like, you know what I'm saying? So I did football and track. But as far as track, like, I didn't lift a single weight till I got to high school.
Okay.
But I was running track. And so when I got to high school, I was like, oh, I can squat good. Like, all this because, I mean, track, just more than any other sport, like, I give respect to track athletes, because that's one sport that, like, if your body isn't close to 100%, especially if you're a sprinter, you cannot perform well. Like, football, you can play through injuries. Like, you know what I'm saying? They're expecting you to. Like, you're never 100%. After fall camp, you know, but track, if something is off, like, you're not gonna be at your best. And like, the amount of details they put in their body, they learn how to take care of their bodies at a higher level than most athletes. The flexibility, all that stuff that they teach you in track, they teach you like the fundamental basics of how to treat your body, just more of anything, you know. Mm-hmm. So track helped me with that. You know, I had a really smart coach. He just knew a lot about the body. Learned a lot from him, which I think in turn helped me a lot just through my you know, journey and everything.
Let's talk about coming to Tennessee, because you guys both came out of big football states, Louisiana and Alabama. Mm-hmm. What stood out to you looking at Tennessee that just didn't compare to the other schools you were also looking at?
Let's see, the fans, obviously, culture here. It's a beautiful place. Why wouldn't you want to be here? Coaching style, obviously. Coach Hike, great dude, great guy. Knows what he's talking about on the field, off the field. Like, just him, like, really him. Coach Hype, like, really did it. Like, so,
yeah, for me. Coach Hypeful.
Is, they say don't chase coaches, you know, but it's hard not to, because that is the culture that's being set, you know. Like, I mean, a new coach comes in, they have their own culture that's set, you know. So it's hard not to, you know, be, like, appealed by a certain coach. And so, like, fun fact, like, I mean, I did, when I started getting, like, Tennessee was my second offer my sophomore year under the old coaching staff. And, you know, obviously my favorite player went here, and I was like, SEC school, like, but I got to a point in time where I was like, I told my mom, I was like, I can't go there, because it's just the past coaching, like, the culture, it wasn't right, you know. Like, I looked in the media, and it was like, players getting in trouble. I'm like, how can I go there and develop as a man, you know, outside of football? Coach Hypo comes in, man, I'm talking about, no head coach has ever called me that much in recruiting. And, like, I don't know if you can say the same, but, like, I didn't get calls from the head coach like that. Like, he made it feel normal and regular. Mm-hmm. You know, I feel like some programs, the head coach, like, they try to squeeze in time, but, like, he would call, make sure he would get his calls out. So it's just, like, that made me feel like they really wanted me, you know, like. And I tell this story all the time. That's how I know that he was so serious about family. When I came on my visit, and we was eating dinner at Root Chris, Jabari Small was my host. And Coach Hypels, he's walking around the tables. Keep in mind, like, they've only been here for a couple months. Hasn't played a game yet. Like, only been here for a couple months, still learning new faces. Jabari's mom FaceTimes him, you know. Coach Hypo walks around the table, greets his mom, full name, first name, last name, just ask how she's doing, and it felt real genuine. Like, that was a moment, an unspoken moment, that I was like, okay, they building something real, you know? So I was like, this might be the place.
Right, I think you can tell a difference in coaching staffs when they want to invest in you athletically and then invest in you personally, which is what you're saying about Coach Hypel, is like, he cared about you as the person outside of all of the football stuff.
Yeah.
And you talk about, you were both members of Hypel's first recruiting class here at Tennessee. So how did you guys see the vision of the program back then and get ready to stick with it through the rest of the time?
Yeah, I mean, just, I think having the opportunity to be a part of a new recruiting class and come help establish a culture. When Coach Hypo took his home visit in my house, he was like, you ready to be a leader in your class and on this team and, you know, help establish this culture. And just looking back on the time and seeing how we developed since then, like, that first year we had, like, our freshman year, like, I mean, it's not it, like, better year you could get than that is winning the national championship, SEC championship. Yeah. Like, that was a year. Talk about the experience of people on the team, the leadership, the wins, games in and out. Like, we was like, me and Squirrel would be like, bro, like, it's crazy. Like, our first year here, like, I don't remember our record. We won 11 games, like, you know, but I was like, yeah, this is, you know, this is the place. Like,
oh my gosh, yeah. I mean, that was a huge year that really, like, set the tone for what this program is going to be now.
It is, because, like, okay, last year, you know, I'm not good with records. I take it game by game. But, you know, for most people in the country, that record is good. You know what I'm saying? What we did last year, you know? But, like, we would rather it, because after our first year, our freshman year, how we set that standard, you know what I'm saying? You would want people to be, okay, this is not the standard. Even though, like, some people would consider that a good season. Like, that's good that we have established the culture of we expecting greatness, you know, and, like, nothing else. And that's what we are striving for, like, every day.
I want to go, like, down memory lane a little bit with you guys and talk about some of your firsts here on campus. Can you walk me through your first game day experience? Going through the Vol Walk, being in Neyland, hearing the band playing Rocky Top for the first time, what do you remember about that?
Snap, you got it.
What you remember about running through the T?
Run through the T? The first game, I don't really remember. I remember Florida game though, like when it was checkerboard, like
Florida game. Florida game.
That was like a movie, like nothing. I was like, what the crap? Like running through the TA, like it just split open. Like I just see like hundreds of thousands like fans, like orange, white section. I was like, what the crap? And it was loud too, so like it was crazy. Like
yeah, it was. You know, think about that first game was a night game.
Oh yeah, that first. Oh.
So we was, I just remember being in the hotel all day, just like you know what I'm saying? Like I'm ready.
I'm not gonna lie, that went like fast though. Like
it did, but it's like I just remember, like still to this day, night games make me feel like that.
Yeah.
But I just remember like running through the tee. I thought that was like before we got to Florida. I was like, no way it get better than this. It got better.
Yeah.
But it's just like I remember the first time I got in too on the first game. I was wondering like what it was gonna be like to play in front of that many people. Like it was just the anxiousness. Like I've never played in front of that many people before where they surround you, you know? So I was just interested in like what it's gonna be like. But when I got in there, it just felt like practice. I'm looking at the sideline, getting calls, like it's like, okay, after that first snap, I'm like, it's ball, you know?
All right, my first snap, the first thing I do remember this. It was a screen. I was behind the outside receiver. I caught the little screen, try to go upfield, and I fail. Like, it's a clip. I feel like that was. I was like, oh wow, that can't happen no more.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it was crazy though.
Yeah.
What do you remember about your first touchdown in Neyland? And I have it down. If you need a quick reminder, because Squirrel first career receiving touchdown against UT Martin after hauling a 64-yard bomb from Milton in the fourth quarter. What do you remember about that touchdown?
Man, I remember just seeing the ball, just like. Like landing to my hands and then like getting in the end zone. I was thinking like, what should I do? I did like the little hamstring, like fake the hamstring injury and then like do the little, what's that like?
The stand walk.
Yeah, the stand walk.
The stand walk.
And I ain't do it right. Cause like, I don't know, it was kind of weird, but it was amazing just to score Neyland for the first time in front of those fans. It was crazy, mm-hmm. Yeah.
The fireworks go off, the band starts playing. It's pretty electric. Okay, Dylan. First career touchdown, rushing touchdown, in your collegiate debut, 2 yard into the end zone, season opener against Ball State.
Yeah, I was just in my whole mind that day. I was like, look, I gotta score. Like, if I get in, if we get to the red zone, I gotta find a way to get in the zone. And like, they blessed me with the run calls. You know what I'm saying? Obviously, they were looking out, but. When I got in the end zone, like, cause I remember I met contact, like there was somebody unblocked, but I was like, he is not finna tackle me. Like I'm finna get in the end zone. And then like the whole like stadium like lit up and like I was the upperclassman, like they came, jumped on the field with me, like big old, did a little handshake with me. I was like, they was happy for me, you know? So it was just like it's college football, like mm-hmm. Now it's time to, you know, keep going.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was there a moment, whether it was spring practice, fall camp, that you were like, oh, this isn't high school football anymore. Like, this is the real deal, and we're doing it at a Power 5 school.
Like freshman, yeah?
Yeah.
Bowl prep. I came here on bowl prep around December or whatever. We was in practice, like, me and K-Well, like, this was my first time, like, being out on the practice field. And, like, we got, like, the pre-practice period, like, where, like, special teams and stuff like that. Like, we work on, like, returners, like, catching off the jugs. And, like, I just remember, like, the receivers breaking it down, and, like, I didn't know where to go. I was just, like, stuck, like, right there. Like, where do I go? Like, where do I go now? And then Poe just told me, come back there with them on the catch on returner jugs. And then, let's see, I was on scout on bowl prep. And, like, I had, like, some type of, like, in route or whatever, and like the ball just went straight through my hands, and all I see is JB, Jeremy Baines, just saying, catch the ball, and like I was like, oh snap, like he talking to me, like that, I was like kind of scared, and so like, oh snap, like this is the real thing, like so yeah, that was for me.
I remember Coach Hyper texted me, he was like, you should see Squirrel in this jersey. They had you in a big jersey or something.
Yeah, I was 148 like coming in.
I'm not gonna lie. I think for me, because I came in the summer, everything is fast paced. Like they coaches are fast paced. Like in the spring, they give you time to like adjust and you know, it's work, you got a little more time. Summer, we get a fall camp and season. So it's like, look, I ain't had no time to like mess up because I knew they wouldn't like trust me. But like, I think even before I got on the field, like everything was just moving so fast. Like early morning workouts, like I just remember being on the field for the workout for a first time, like it felt like I was in like doing drills. Sergeant, like Coach Schmidt came out there like so serious, and we line up in lines. Like I got these clothes I never worn before. I'm bro, this real. Like, and then like just meetings and everything. I'm like, this is college. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like before I even got to the practice field, I was like, this is college. You know what I'm saying?
Was it your freshman year that you roomed together? Were you guys roommates?
We was roommates.
Sophomore year.
Sophomore year.
Yeah. You might as well say like freshman year. We was like
freshman and sophomore year.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. What was it like living together?
I told him like after he moved, I was like, he said, you going to get a roommate? No. Like at this point, I'm like, I'm not like living with nobody else. Cause like, you know what I'm saying? I think it was also on the same page. Just like the stuff, things we value and how we operate. So it was smooth, you know, like when we would come back, like, we wouldn't even really talk about football, like unless that's it was nice. Like after a game. Like during the season, we would ride together, we'd ride back. It was just funny, like especially this past season. You know, we talk about things and stuff like that. But you know, half the time we just be chilling, like, you know. So I think it was just the fact that we could see eye to eye, and, you know, how we operate. He'll come knock on my door if I'm sleeping too long. D-Cell.
I'd be like, I can ride with you in the morning. He'd be like, yeah.
I'd be like, yeah.
But like, even after like workouts or whatever, like we do our little thing. Like we come back home, like we'll chill on the couch, take a nap, watch movies and stuff like that.
Yeah.
We just chill together. Like it's just.
Yeah.
Were you guys clean roommates? Are you
a little
messy?
Nah, we just clean.
Okay.
We just clean. Like.
Would you cook a lot?
He's the cooker. Okay. Like, you know where he from.
You lucky you.
He started cooking though. But yeah, we'll cook every now and then.
Yeah.
You know, just do like hamburgers. I make red beans and rice or something.
The red beans and rice. Oh my gosh.
I mean, I just made something I forgot to tell you.
For real?
Yeah.
Ain't no way, bro.
Bad on me. Yeah, bro.
Is there one play, it could either be your own personal or one that you watched from the sideline or you were on the field for, that you remember the most last year that just stands out in your mind?
All right, fourth quarter, Kentucky. This guy, he led us to, I'll say, game winner or whatever like that. He carried us or whatever on that fourth quarter, put the team on the back.
Couldn't do without my teammates.
But yeah,
that's what you remember.
Yeah, that's what I remember.
And when it comes to me, I probably that just the end of that Kentucky game. That's probably where I just felt the most, just in my zone.
Mm-hmm.
Like I knew I was staying in the game, so it was just like it's like I had the keys at that moment in time. So it was just like I was just playing as comfortable as possible. So it was just like that's the feeling I always want to get back to, or when I need to give myself some positive. Positivity. I think about just how free I felt, you know, and how willing I was to do anything, you know, in that moment to get the win.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's not forget about Squirrel's catch, though, against South Carolina. Was that South Carolina? Yep. All black. Yeah. face, pass interference. That should have been top 10. Sports Center. Then you got up and celebrated.
Coaching-wise, I want to talk about both of your position coaches as well, Coach Pope and Coach Sims now for you. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about how Coach Pope has helped develop you as an athlete and the man that you are today?
Oh, yeah. as a player, he helped me develop develop good off the field and on the field. But on the field, just him, like, pushing me every day to be the best, like, best football player I can be or even a leader. Like, he puts me in, like, tough positions, like gets me out of my comfort zone, like talking up, like leading our receiver group or whatever, and just stand on top of me like each and every day.
Mm-hmm. So. And Coach Sims, what about him for you? Because he's been around for a couple weeks, couple months now. So what have you seen out of him that you've really latched onto?
I was actually able to, you know, have a previous relationship with him in recruiting, and I say that's like one of the most genuine coaches. Mm-hmm. I've ever talked to in recruiting. So when he got hired, like me and my family were like, okay, like if you're gonna replace Coach Mack, that's how you know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm saying? At least get a good hearted person. But talk about someone who will come in and establish like their presence, you know what I'm saying? Make his culture and his expectations known, like took no time to understand how he operates and like what he expects of us. You know, knows the in and out details of just being a running back, like the drills he has us do, just the finer details of us taking our game to the next level, in more depth terms of the actual running back position.
Okay.
You know, he's very good with that. And then, like, even though he hasn't been here for so long, like, we'll start the meeting every day with, like, something motivational. You know, he'll have it in his PowerPoint. Like, you know, like I said, he'll come in and establish his presence while allowing us to be us, too. So, you know, he'll ask us, what's the word of the day? He'll randomly ask us, give us some encouragement, you know? Mm-hmm. So he just does a good job being that motivator, you know what I'm saying, very high energy coach. Mm-hmm. You know, I just can't wait to continue to grow and go through the season with him and, you know, just continue to learn and, you know, hear everything he has to offer.
Feels like the off season flew by, but there's not even like an off season these days. And at college athletics, you guys are on the go and self-motivated, you know, through this time. So did you get any like downtime to like reset, relax? Did you go home at all? Did you get a nice break?
Yeah, it's you know, we don't get that much time, but you know, we got a good like spring break and I was able to go home. My brother just had a new niece. I was able to visit my niece.
Congratulations.
But like, I think because we don't get that much time, like the time we do get, we value it more than others. Mm-hmm. You know, like just a regular day we could be excited about having. It's just a normal day for like anybody else who probably isn't in college athletic, but we'd be like ecstatic about it and just very hyper. But I think we, like when those days do come, we don't take it for granted.
Mm-hmm.
You know, those days are also important because like, you know, you have to find time to reset. So like, when you are in the building and when you are in this, you could be fully in this,
mm-hmm.
you know? So taking those moments are important.
No, that's such a good point because I feel like as the college athletes, you make so many sacrifices to be in the position that you are and to be able to succeed in the position that you're in. So when you do get that time with family and being present with them is really important, no matter if it's 2 or 3 days, you'll take it for what it's worth, but then come back and start the grind all over again. Squirrel, I saw you at a Preds game too. Yeah, wait, tell me about that. How did that come to be?
Oh, yeah, that was lit. Grant Furkin, he hit me up, asked me if I want to go to a hockey game. I said, yeah, why not? I've never been to a hockey game. The only thing I know about hockey is, like, they just box. Like,
right. So, they get in brawls, yeah.
Yeah, it was fun. I went there with some of my homeboys back at the crib. It was excited. They was excited to be there with me in Nashville. It was the first time going to Nashville.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, you got a real experience, like full experience of Nashville.
Yeah, it was fun, though.
What are your impressions of hockey now? Like, are you gonna be a regular fan of the NHL?
I'm a Preds fan.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So like,
hands
down. I definitely gotta go back to a hockey game.
Yeah,
so.
I saw you with the towel, looking it around.
Yeah, yeah, I had to get the crowd lit and stuff.
That's so fun. Squirrel, I will have to say congratulations to you as well because you're expecting your first kid very soon, like
a
couple days, couple weeks out, right?
Yeah, could be any time for now.
Spring games.
Yeah, let's just hope. But I got a son on the way.
Congratulations, so. That's so exciting. Do you have a name picked out for him?
Oh yeah, I chose the first name. She chose the middle name, and I really wanted to name him Squirrel.
Squirrel Jr.
Yeah, Squirrel Jr. But
what's he gonna call him? You know the nickname?
Oh, yeah, the nickname, his nickname is going to be Chipmunk.
So. Okay. Chip. Oh, wait, I love
Chipmunk.
That.
Yeah, Squirrel and Chipmunk. So, yeah, that's nice, but.
Godfather.
Most definitely, he the godfather.
Absolutely.
So, yeah.
Absolutely. He's got so many great uncles and everything with all the guys on the team.
Definitely.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah,
bring in
it's amazing.
To some games this fall, too. Get him those soundproof
headphones. Yeah, the headphones. Yeah, it'd be lit.
Yes.
Yeah,
well, congratulations. Definitely. I hope it's a healthy and happy baby when he arrives. And I hope everything goes well with the delivery.
Thank you.
Let's talk about, real quick, too, the spring game, because we're in the middle of spring practices. What are you looking forward to? I know it's been a couple months since we've been out to Neyland, just getting back out there and being able to play with your guys again.
Man, the stadium,
it's just always
coach say like it's only one way you play when you go on stuff in Neyland.
Yeah.
So
you know, it's just, you know, it's blessing every time we get back in there. I know fans will be limited, but even with fans limited, it's still a lot of people in there. And I think everybody in Knoxville is just itching for football season come back.
I know I am.
You know, I think that's just the heartbeat.
All right, my last question for you guys. We ask everybody on the podcast this question. When you sing Rocky Top, do you woo?
Oh, most definitely you got to.
Rocky.
Like,
woo. Like that.
Rocky Top, you'll always be.
You got to woo.
Home sweet home to me. Good old Rocky Top.
Ooh, see, you got to.
With the pom-pom, like, oh, the hand. Yeah. Okay. Ooh,
yeah. I just love, oh, yeah. I love when they start singing all the songs. What's the one? Low Places, Friends in Low Places?
Yep.
Man, that's going to be in my head forever. Just when it, and all on my, like, they do that. That puts me in, like, the most happy mood ever.
Aw, it's some fourth quarter?
I think it's fourth quarter.
Swag Surf, and then we go into Low Places.
And then everybody's just singing at the same time. And it echoes. Like, I know if you're outside the stadium, like, you can definitely hear that.
Most definitely from the river.
Miles away.
Even the music will cut off sometimes, and they're still singing the song in the stadium.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, so that's definitely cool.
My phone.
That's definitely going to be.
Well, on that note, time to wrap things up. Yep. Thank you all so much for talking with me today. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for listening to another episode of your favorite sports podcast, Everything Orange. As always, be sure to follow us on all of our Vol Sports platforms so you don't miss out on a single update. But before we go, here's a look at everything going on with Tennessee Athletics this upcoming week. Today through Saturday, track is competing in the Brian Clay Invitational in California. Tomorrow, track is also competing in the two-day Tom Jones Memorial Invitational in Gainesville. Women's golf kicks off day one of the SEC Championship in Florida. Women's tennis takes on Kentucky at 4 p.m. in Barksdale Stadium. Softball travels to Starkville, Mississippi for game one against the Bulldogs at 7 p.m. And baseball hosts game one against the LSU Tigers at 7:30 in Lindsey Nelson Stadium. At 1 p.m. on Saturday, football plays its orange and white game. Fan capacity will be limited, but you can still come to campus for fun and festive game day experiences. And then also stick around for baseball's second game against LSU. First pitch is at 5:30. Also on Saturday, soccer plays Wake Forest at 2:30 in Regal Soccer Stadium. Softball plays game two against Mississippi State at 3 p.m. And volleyball travels to Kentucky to take on Louisville at 5 p.m. On Sunday, women's tennis hosts Vanderbilt at 1 p.m. in Barksdale Stadium. Men's tennis travels to Lexington, Kentucky to take on the Wildcats at 1 p.m. Softball plays its last game in its series against Mississippi State at 1 p.m. And baseball plays its last game against LSU at 3 p.m. On Tuesday, baseball hosts its midweek game against Bellarmine at 6 p.m. And lastly, on Wednesday, men's and women's tennis kick off day one of the SEC Championships. The women down in Athens, Georgia, and the men out in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Well, that's a wrap on Rocky Top. Make sure to tune in next Thursday for another episode of Everything Orange. Bye, y'all.